Good morning, students. Last video, we were discussed the network, difference between network and networking, embedded networking, I/O devices with the ports and buses, internal block diagram of an embedded processors, and serial bus communication types. Let us discuss the remaining topics one by one in this video. So this is standard serial port. Serial port is an interface that enables a PC to transmit or receive data one bit at a time. It is one of the oldest interface types and has been commonly used to connect printers and external modems to a PC at one time. Modern serial ports are used in scientific instruments, shops, till systems such as cash registers and applications such as industrial machinery systems. The data transfer rate of the serial port is slower compared to the parallel port. Normally, a serial port is a male port while a female port is a parallel port. System resources, system resource configuration are chosen for each port are identified by COM1, COM2, COM3 and COM4 and so on. Each COM position represents an input output and an interrupt request register or address. The I/O address transfers and receives data from and to a peripheral device such as mouse or keyboard. So this is the pin details and the connection details of MAX RS-232. The standard serial port is RS-232. The standard is used for transmission of serial communication between devices, usually referred to as data communication equipment, that is DCE, and data terminal equipment, that is DTE. The serial port uses a 9-pin DE9 connectors or a 25-pin, that is DB25 connector. Originally, 25 pins were used by the standard because many of the pins were unused and quite bulky. The smaller DE9 connector became popular. High speed communication for serial communications such as external data storage units was needed. In 1998, the Universal Serial Bus, that is USB, and FireWire were introduced faster interface. This new technology could transfer data at a higher rate to the same bus called daisy chain technique. Serial port is rarely used today but can be found as a communication device for GPS receivers, LED and LCD text display, barcode scanners and flat screen monitors. The standard serial port was available on the back of the PC and also on the built-in board. This port is on its way to being outdated, but it is a good idea. Have a look at this port, that is compliant with RS-232. It is often referred to as a legacy port, but a hardware designed to connect to the serial is still used. Port particularly for computers used by companies as servers. Usually, built-in software is developed on the host computer and then downloaded to the microcontroller flash unit via the serial port of the computer. In recent cases, the connection between the PC and the target board has been replaced by a USB cable, and there is a JTAG cable for more advanced systems. But many built-in boards still have serial ports. It is likely in some instances that the PC does not have a serial port for communication between two devices, a conversation cable can be used in that case. The serial cable and hyper terminal software available on the PC can be used for two-way communication between a PC and an embedded board. Examples of the serial port include RS-232, RS-422 and RS-485 and so on. See the first example, that is RS-232 standards. RS-232 standards are the primary standards for serial communication, which send data as bits as 1 or 0. These levels correspond to 5 volt and 0 volt as per TTL standard. During transmission over short distance from one room to another room, the TTL level signals are easily corrupted by noise. However, this problem does not normally arise because the data is not being sent or received at the TTL level. Instead of RS-232 standards are used. RS-232C defines a different set of voltage or current. RS-232 stands for Recommended Standard Number 232 and C is the most recent revision of the standard. By this standard, TTL voltages are changed to the level between minus 3 to minus 25 volt for 1 and plus 3 to plus 25 for a 0. This means that the bits should be updated to this level and reconverted to TTL levels on receiving before sending them. There are some standard chips available to do this. RS-232 level converters, either TTL or CMOS logic levels are required to use all digital devices. The MAX-232 is an IC for conversion to and from these levels to RS-232 levels. The pinout and connections for this MAX-232 chip are shown in this diagram. The MAX-232 IC pin indicates that an RS-232 transmission signal is received and RS-232 receives a signal from it. On a regular serial port, these pins of the IC are terminated. So this is about RS-232 pin details and connection details. So this is the pin details of RS-232, that is DB connectors. RS-232 defines a standard of 25 pins leading to a 25 pin connector, but most serial ports need only a subset of the RS-232 standards. For normal PC communication, most of these pins are not required, and indeed most PCs are equipped with male D-type connectors having only 9 pins. This shows the DB9 connector and describes the DB9 connector pin functions in the next slide. See here. But again, even though the standard connector have 9 pins, serial communication is possible with just 3 pins. One is a transmit data, another one receive data, another one ground signal. See the slide. This is receive data, this is transmit data, this is ground signal. So using these 3 pins, the data are transmitted from one device to another device. So this is computer port, this is joint port. Here pin number 2 acts as a receive data, pin number 3 acts as a transmit data. So through pin number 3, the data are transmitted to the joint port. Using pin number 2, that information are received. Okay, that is R cross D, received data. Similarly, the joint port send the information through pin number 3, that is the transmit data. Here, computer port receives that information through pin number 2, that is R cross D. Then pin number 5 acts as ground signal. Okay. So this shows two serial ports connected through a 3-wire cable. So any microcontroller unit will have two serial communication pins, receive data and transmit data for receiving and transmitting signals. For example, PIC controller, 8051 controller, then AVR, etc. Microcontroller units have an inbuilt universal asynchronous receiver transmitter, that is UART, the function of which is to convert the parallel data available in the microcontroller unit registers to serial form to put on transmit data, and also to convert the serial data received on receive data back into parallel form. The rate at which serial data transfer occurs is determined by the baud rate setting in the UART registers to take the serial data out of the board through the serial port. They have to be converted to RS-232 level signals, and this is done by the level converter MAX-232 IC or other ICs with similar functions. See the diagram. This is MAX-232 and microcontroller and a serial port on an embedded board. So this is MAX-232 IC. This is microcontroller IC. Here 232 connector is used for connecting these two devices. So this diagram shows the part of an embedded board which contains a MAX-232 IC and microcontroller, and the connection of MAX-232 IC to the serial data pins of the microcontroller and to the DB9 male connector of the serial port. RS-232 is a very popular interface, and a long distance communication is achieved by having modems at the transmission and reception end. Then the next example, that is RS-422 and RS-485. RS-422 and RS-485 are the other type of serial protocols used in instrumentation system and where modems are not used. The main difference between RS-422 and RS-485 and RS-232 is that the signal here are balanced, differential rather than single ended. There are two floating signal wires, V plus and V minus, but no common ground signal. At any time, the difference in the voltage between the two wires is sensed. Thus, any noise which is common to both the wires is cancelled and makes this to be low noise differential signaling. In addition, the two wires are twisted for further noise reduction. Twisting the lines helps to reduce the noise. See the diagram. So this is the effect of twisting wire pairs. Here there is no twisted wire, whereas the second diagram shows the cable are twisted. Okay. So this is a twisted pair cable, whereas here this is a straight cable. Okay. The noise current induced by an external source are reversed in every twist. Instead of amplifying each other as in a straight wire, the reversed noise current reduce each other influence, that is the current get cancelled. Differential signals are twisting that allows RS-485 to communicate over much longer communication distances than RS-232. With RS-485, communication distance of 1200 meters are possible. So this is the advantage of RS-485 cable. Then RS-485 network topology. So network topology is probably the reason why RS-485 is now the favorite of the four mentioned interfaces in data acquisition and control applications. RS-485 is the only of the interface capable of internetworking multiple transmitters and receivers in the same network. When using the default RS-485 receivers with an input resistance of 12 kilo ohm, it is possible to connect 32 devices to the network. Currently available high resistance RS-485 input allow this number to be expanded to 256. RS-485 repeaters are also available, which make it possible to increase the number of nodes to several thousands spanning multiple kilometers. And that with an interface which does not require intelligent network hardware, the implementation on the software side is not much more difficult than with RS-232 cable. It is the reason why RS-485 is so popular with the computers, PLCs, microcontrollers and intelligent sensors in scientific and technical applications. So this is the network topology RS-485. So in the picture here, the general network topology of 485 is shown here. N nodes are connected in a multi-point RS-485 network. For higher speed and longer lines, the termination resistances are necessary on both end of the line to eliminate reflections. Okay, then use 100 ohm resistors on both end. The RS-485 network must be designed as one line with multiple drops, not as a short network. Although total cable length may be shorter in a short configuration, adequate termination is not possible anymore and signal quality may degrade significantly. So this is about RS-485 network topology, that is node connection star network. Then functional of RS-485 cable. All the senders of the RS-485 bus are in tri-state with a high impedance. In most higher level protocols, one of the nodes is defined as a master, which send queries or command over the RS-485 bus. All other nodes receive these data depending on the information in the sent data. Zero or more nodes on the line respond to the master. In this situation, bandwidth can be used for almost 100%. There are other implementations of RS-485 network where every node can start a data session on its own. So this is comparable with the way Ethernet network function, because there is a chance of data collusion with this implementation. Theory tells us that in this case, only 37% of the bandwidth will be effectively used. With such an implementation of a RS-485 network, it is necessary that there is error detection implemented in the higher level protocol to detect the data corruption and resend the information at a later time. There is no need for the sender to explicitly turn the RS-485 driver on or off. RS-485 drivers automatically return to the high impedance at tri-state within a few microseconds after the data has been sent. Therefore, it is not needed to have delays between the data packets on the RS-485 bus. RS-485 is used as the electrical layer for many well-known interface standards, including Profibus and Modbus. Therefore, RS-485 will be used for many years in the future. So, this is the comparison chart of RS-232, RS-422 and RS-485. See here, cabling. So this is single cable. This is single ended multi-drop cable. This one is multi-drop cable. Then here, number of devices. One transistor and one receiver in case of RS-232. Whereas here, RS-422, 5 transmitters and 10 receivers are used. Whereas RS-485, 32 transmitters and 32 receivers are used. Then communication mode, here half duplex or full duplex mode is used. RS-422, half duplex or full duplex. Similarly, 485 also the same. That is a half duplex or full duplex mode is used. Then maximum distance, RS-232 covers 50 feet to 1.92 kilometer per kilobits per second. Whereas RS-422, 4000 feet to 100 kilobits per second. Whereas RS-485, 4000 feet, that is 100 kilobits per second. Okay, the first one is distance, that is here RS-232, that is 50 feet. Here RS-422 uses 4000 feet, RS-485 uses 4000 feet. Here 1.92 kilobits per second, bits are transmitted. Here 100 bits are bits per second transmitted. Here 100 kilobits per second are transmitted. Then signaling, this is unbalanced. The remaining two, that is RS-422 and RS-485, both are balanced signaling. So this is the comparison chart of RS-232, RS-422 and RS-485. The next topic is networked automotive electronic modules using different buses. Before that, already I said the difference between 485 and 422. Many of the features in both RS-485 and RS-422 are the same. There is one prominent difference. The former is a multi-point protocol, while the latter is a multi-drop protocol. Both of them allow the direct connection of intelligent devices without the need of modems. But they are half duplex protocols. RS-422 line drive can serve up to 10 receivers in parallel. Thus, one central control unit can send command in parallel to 10 slave devices. But these slave devices cannot send information back to the server, that is back over a shared interface line. Thus, the network topology possible is only multi-drop. For a multi-point network, where all nodes are considered equal and every node has send and receive capabilities over the same line, RS-485 interface can be used. Up to 32 parallel send and receive units can exist on one communication channel. So, this is about RS-422 and RS-485. So, this is next topic, that is a controller area network, that is CAN. CAN is a protocol developed to reduce the wiring inside the vehicle. So, this was introduced in 1984 by Bosch company. After 1990, the bus became very popular and is now the de facto standard for automotive buses. There are different standard versions for CAN, that is low speed CAN, standard CAN, then extended CAN. Low speed means that is 125 kilobits per second. Here 11 bit identifier. Then standard CAN uses 1 megabits per second. That is a standard CAN, that is 2.0A. So here 11 bit identifier is used. Then third type, that is extended CAN 2.0B. Here also 1 megabits per second. Here 29-bit identifier. The CAN protocol is used in many units in a vehicle. Its interesting feature is that it is an interconnection network. Okay, in vehicle, it may be used to interconnect between the engine control unit and transmission control unit. A lowest speed CAN is sufficient to connect the modules of door lock, seat control, climate control, etc. So, this part is called as the body electronics of the vehicle. In one vehicle itself, there can be different CAN buses of different data rates. There can be other kind of buses also in a vehicle. To connect between buses of different speed and of different standards, bridges are used. So, this diagram shows three different buses with different bit rates catering to a different set of modules. The next slide shows CAN node. So, the CAN bus connects different nodes. Here, this diagram, that is a microcontroller, a CAN controller and transceiver connected to a CAN bus through line drivers. To the microcontroller I/O pins, senders and activators are connected. Because of its popularity, many microcontroller manufacturers have now added CAN controller unit in this product. That is inside the microcontroller, making it is a reliable, efficient and low cost option. Then many PIC, AVR and the ARM processor, then microcontroller have CAN controller as an integrated unit. CAN is now used as well as in machine and factory automation product. Okay, see here the next diagram. So, this is nodes connected through a CAN bus. Here, CAN bus and number of CAN nodes are connected to it. Then, CAN protocol. See here, case 1, no node, send a message. CAN is a message based protocol. One node broadcast a message. This means that every other node can use it. But unlike I2C, none of the nodes have addresses. This depends on the content of the message. So, the message has a field with an identifier, which also indicates a priority. The receiving nodes do an acceptance test for the identifier of the message to verify if the message is relevant for it and accept it if it is relevant. Otherwise, the message is ignored. The selection processing is called acceptance filtering at each station, that is node. Then in case 2, many nodes send many messages. When many nodes send messages simultaneously, it is necessary that only one node is allowed to do a valid broadcast. Other transmitter should retreat and try again later. Then arbitration is the mechanism that handles bus access conflict. Then the technique of the arbitration used is similar to the identifier of the messages, have dominant, that is 11 bit to 29 bit, and receives bits 0 is the dominant bit and 1 is the receiver bit. Then the logic is wired, and where the presence is a 0 causes the output to be a 0. Example, consider 3 nodes transmitting at the same time. Let's consider that the 11 bit identifier of the 3 messages have all the lower 8 bits as 0. In the arbitration phase, the comparison of the lower 8 bits do not cause any decision to be made. The 9 bit of the identifier is 1 for node Z alone.
Okay, so when contending, that is when contend for the bus, no two losses arbitration at this point of time. Then comes to 10B, which is one for the message of node 3. Thus, node 3 also losses out and node 1 left with its message on the bus. See the next diagram. So, this diagram is for understanding this method in the case of example message identifier. This technique is called CSMA or CD, which stands for carrier sensor multiple access. Carrier sensor multiple access or collision detection. When multiple access occurs, collision detection is done by sending the carrier, and on the basis of this, arbitration is done. The coding of the identifier of the message should obviously be in such a way that more important action should be given higher priorities. So, these are the features of CAN. This diagram shows a CAN device connected to a CAN bus, where two signal wires, that is CAN L, CAN H, are same. So this is called differential signaling, and the effective signal is the difference of that in two wires. When common mode signal, usually noise, appear on the bus, they are subtracted off, and this makes the CAN bus resistant to noise. In CAN and most other modern serial protocols, differential signaling with N or Z coding is used to reduce its effect of noise. A CAN bus is a terminator to minimize signal reflection on the bus. The ISO 11898 requires that the bus has a characteristic impedance of 120 ohm. Okay, then message frames. Okay, so this is message frame. CAN distinguishes four message format, that is data, remote, error, and overall, that is overland frames. So see the diagram. Data frame, the data frame begins with the start of frame, that is SOF bit. It is followed by an 11 bit identifier, and the remote transmission request, that is RTR bit. So this bit can be used to tell any other node to transmit instead of just listening. Okay, the identifier and the RTR bit from the arbitration field. The control field consists of 6 bits and indicates how many bytes of data follow in the data field. So the data field can be 0 to 8 bytes. So the data field is followed by the cyclic redundancy checksum, that is a CRC field, which enables the receiver to check if the receiver bit is sequence was corrupted. The 2 bit acknowledgement, that is ACK field, is used by the transmitter to receive an acknowledgement of a valid frame from any receiver. The message frame is terminated by a 7 bit end of frame, that is EOF. For CAN 2.0B, the identifier is 29 bits long instead of the 11 bit of CAN 1.0. CAN has become very popular and widely used protocol because of its simplicity, low cost, sophisticated error detection and handling system. Its maximum range is typically 40 meters, okay, at 1 megabits per second, but the data rate decreases with the increase in range. Okay, then CAN and the OSI model. Using the 7-layer open system interconnection model, that is OSI, several network protocols are defined. The CAN protocol says out of the two lowest layers of the OSI, the model, that is the connection of the data and the physical layer. There are several higher level protocols that are standardized based on CAN, okay, that is application layer. The selection of the user depends on the application. The next slide shows SPI signal with the master and one slave. So SPI is nothing but serial peripheral interface. Okay, serial peripheral interface bus. So the SPI bus was developed by Motorola. The name SPI suggests it is a serial data transfer protocol, which is synchronous and full duplex between microcontroller unit and peripheral. As a system, it is a single master, multi-slave system in which only one of the slave is to be enabled at a time. It is a master-slave protocol in the sense that the master is the unit that generates the clock signal and initiate data transfer. When the master does this, data transfer occurs in both the directions simultaneously. This diagram shows the signal of the SPI bus in a single slave configuration. There are four wires, serial clock, then MOSI, that is serial clock, clock generated by the master. Then MOSI, which carries data from the master to slave device. Then MISO, which carries data from the slave to master. Then SS, the slave select signal. The last pin, that is a SS, slave select of the master, is to be connected to the chip enable pin of the slave to be selected and is usually an active low signal. Then MOSI, already I said, master out, slave in. MISO is nothing but master in, slave out signal. So this is SPI connection for one master and three slaves. So this is master SPI. This is slave 1, this is slave 2, this is slave 3. Using these four signals, the slave devices are connected to the master devices. So this diagram shows multi-slave SPI configuration. The master is usually a microcontroller which has SPI controller with the specified pins. The microcontroller SPI controller unit has 3 SS pins, but only one slave is selected at a time. Slaves that are currently not selected should have the MOSI and MISO tri-stated and thus be isolated from the system. Then this diagram, that is SPI transaction using shift register. Okay, so this is SPI protocol. So the transfer of data using on SPI interface can be thought of as a large shift register shared between the master and slave device. Data is clocked in at the same time as it is clocked out of the device, that is, the clock is shared by the two devices. In addition, there should be transmit buffer register at the transmitter side and a receiver buffer register at the receiver side. So here, the SPI protocol behaves like a ring buffer, so that whenever the master send a byte to the slave, the slave send a byte back to the master device. Okay, so essentially two action takes place in a SPI clock cycle. They are, the master send a bit on the MOSI line, which the slave reads from the same line. Then second one is, the slave send a bit on the MISO line and the master read it from the same line. Okay, see here, The diagram shows the data transfer between a master and slave device. So here shift register in the master and a slave, which is a serially connected using MOSI and MISO pins. So in this connection, a bit is shifted from master to slave and slave to master simultaneously. Not all transmissions require all this operation to be meaningful, but this is the way the protocol works. If the individual shift register are 8 bit long, it is apparent that after 8 clock cycles, the data in the master and the slave gets exchanged. The length of the shift register is decided by the manufacturer of the SPI controller. Then the length of the shift register is decided by the manufacturer of the SPI controller. Once a set of data has been transmitted, the buffer at the transmitter side should get fresh data to be sent. Similarly, the received data should be copied and the saved at the receiver side. This process can continue until the required block of data is transferred. Okay, then important points in SPI.
So SPI can operate at a higher speed compared to I2 protocol, but it has a serious problem in that it has no acknowledged signal, that is acknowledgement signal. So the master has no way of confirming the recipient of the data sent. So this is the drawback of SPI device. Then the protocol works best for a single slave system. Okay, then clock frequency up to 70 MHz are possible. Then slave devices such as a serial EEPROM, flash memory, LCD drivers, memory cards, serial ADC, etc. are the devices that are frequently used in the SPI protocol. Then popular microcontroller devices like ARM controller, PIC controller, AVR, etc. have SPI controller as a standard features. So this diagram shows the connection between PIC microcontroller and SD card. See this diagram, this is I2C devices with one master and N slave devices. So this is inter-integrated circuit protocol. I2C is nothing but inter-integrated circuit. So this is called as I2C or I2C. Okay. It is nothing but it is a simple two-wire protocol with just two wires. One is a serial clock, another one serial data. These two wires are used for data transmission. Okay, so this device was developed by Philips in 1980 for its TV application, which required the connection of a CPU to many ICs. Nowadays, this bus is very widely used in the embedded field. So this is a synchronous half duplex serial protocol and is also byte oriented, which means that one byte is sent but one bit at a time in a serial fashion. After each byte, an acknowledgement is to be sent by the receiver. Integrate a circuit to the sender IC. So this is the simplest form. This can have one master and many slaves. The master usually a microcontroller unit, and that unit can transmit any information as well as a receive information. So all the slave depending on whether they are input or output devices. For example, a slave which is a ROM can only be read from LCD controller, can only be write to, while an external RAM chip can be read and write. The two signal wires are bidirectional and carry the signals serial clock, serial data. So each device has its own unique address, usually fixed by hardware. So this diagram shows the two active wires connected to pull-up resistors, that is wired and connection, indicating that they are open collector or open drain connection, depending on whether the technology is BJT or MOS. Then the next slide shows functions between master and slave devices. First, the master issues a short signal. This signal causes all the slaves to come to attention and listen. The start condition corresponds to the action of the master pulling the SDA line low when the clock is high. See here. So this is serial data. So initially the clock is high. Okay, during start of the condition, that is the starting condition, the clock signal is high. The first byte sent by the master in the address, this address 7 bit, okay, is sent serially on the SDA line. Okay, that is MSB first. Note that the bits on the SDA line are synchronized by the clock signal on the SCL line, which means that the data on the SDA line is read during the time that the clock on the serial clock line is high. That is, data is valid at the low to high transistor of the clock. Then after that, the master also send read or write signal indicating the direction of the data transfer. Note that all the activities are synchronized by the clock signal. Then only one, the slave will have the broadcasted address and no realization that its address matches with this address. The particular slave respond by sending an acknowledgement signal back to the master. Now, a byte can be received from the slave if the read or write bit is set to read, otherwise it is to be written in the slave. Once this data transfer is over, the master or slave has received the byte, send an acknowledge signal. So acknowledgement is when the receiver driver SDA is low. If more bytes are to be transferred, step number 5 and 6 are repeated. Okay, then after that, the master pulls the SCL high and the SDA line also. This amount of that is the amount to a stop condition when the bus is idle, also indicating that it is available for use by other slaves. The I2C bus was originally developed by a multi-master bus. So this means that more than one device initiating transfer can be active in the system. In such a case, each master will have arbitrate for the bus. Then I2C controller have the additional hardware and protocol for this. So there are three standard for I2C bus and have the following three speed. One is a slow speed, another one fast speed, and third one is a high speed. The slow speed is in the range of 100 kilobits per second. Fast speed means 400 kilobits per second. High speed means 3.4 megabits per second. So due to the popularity of its I2C bus, the 7-bit address space soon got exhausted for those who are designing new I2C compatible ICs. this become a problem, and so the I square C strand, that is I square C standard, has been updated to implement a 10-bit addressing mode. A chip that conforms to the new standard receives two address bytes. The first consists of the extended address, reserved address, including two upper bits of the device address and read-write bit. The second byte contains the lower bits of the address. Any new design should implement this new address scheme. The I2C protocol is very simple, but it is not as fast as the competing SPI scheme. Then I2C devices include EEPROM, thermal sensors, real-time clocks, and similar peripherals which have one data line and one clock line can be programmed by microcontroller. Many standard microcontrollers like PIC, AVR, PSOC, then ARM processor, etc. have I2C hardware within SDA and SCL lines as pins, so that the protocol can be easily implemented. So this is about SDA and SCL of I2C protocol. So the next topic is device driver. Device driver is nothing but device driver in computing refers to a specific kind of software program or specific type of software application which controls a specific hardware device that enables a different hardware device for communication with the computer's operating system. A device driver communication with the computer hardware by computer subsystem or computer bus connected to the hardware. Device driver are very essential for computer system to work properly, because without device driver, the particular hardware fails to work accordingly, means it fails in doing a particular function or action for which it has been created. So, in a very common way, most term is only driver, that driver, okay. Also, when someone says a hardware driver, that also refers to device driver. So, device driver can classify as follows. The first one is block device drivers, second one character device driver, and third one is network device driver. See the first one, block device driver. So this is a driver that is well suited for block device which transfer data in blocks, like for example disk drivers, etc. Such IO devices have block sized buffers as part of the buffer cache in memory. Then second type, that is a character device drivers. As the name signifies, this is used for device which move data as characters and therefore does not need a buffer cache. A line printer is one such device where data is sent as characters, but such drivers are not limited to application that handle data as characters. Some devices that handle data as large chunk of data are also within, this is the class, the characteristics, that is the data is to be transferred directly without buffering. Most drivers belong to this class. And third type, that is a network device drivers. So this type of drivers has to set up and prepare a network for a data transmission and reception and handle all the information and protocol involved. Okay, so this is about device drivers. Okay, see the next diagram. So these devices are used in case of device drivers. So device drivers depend upon the operating system instructions to access the device and performing any particular action. So after the action, they also shows the reactions by delivering output or status or message from hardware device to the operating system. For example, a printer driver tells the printer in which format to print after getting instruction from operating system. Similarly, a sound card driver is the due to which ones and zeros data of MP3 file is converted to audio signals and you enjoy the music. And third example, card reader or controller or modem network card, then sound card, printer, video card, USB device, RAM, speakers, etc. need device drivers to operate. See, so these are all softwares. Okay, so the software contains application, operating system and device drivers. So the user give the input value. So from that, the operating system, the information will send it to the operating system. Okay, then using that value, that is the hardware will process that. Using that information, the hardware follow that rules and programs, follow the actions, okay, using device drivers. So this is about device drivers. So what we have discussed so far, what is called bus, then what is mean by IO bus. IO bus is also called as peripheral bus. Then what is mean by onboard bus, then offboard bus. Okay, then after that, serial communication system. Okay, then after that, legacy port. That is what is meant by legacy port. So legacy port is nothing but the standard serial port is on its way to obsolescence, but it will be a good idea to have a look at this RS-232 compliant port. It is often called legacy port. Then after that, CAN. Okay, that is a different CAN, depends upon its speed. It can be divided in three types. That is a low speed, then standard speed, then external CAN, like that. Then after that, what is body electronics. Then what are the actions of SPI clock cycle. Okay, then what is I2C. Then different speed levels of I2C. That is a low speed means under 100 kilobits per second, fast means 400 kilobits per second, then high speed means 3.4 megabits per second. Okay, that information. Then after that, standard microcontroller units like a PIC, AVR, PSOC, then ARM processor, etc. Then device drivers classification. So device driver classification, there are three types. The first one is block device drivers, character device drivers, network device drivers, etc. So I think no doubt about this unit. We will see in the next unit, in the next video. Thank you.